Okay, guys, listen up. This is going to be really fast in doing this. Our main purpose with this 2002 Toyota is not that we walk start to finish, like case study, misfire. We're gonna do that. Partly, my main focus is I want you guys to understand how to use this scope. It was really what we were lacking today. As you know, this is only our second day in the shop. So we're gonna use, instead of just having like a button pushing class and having a scope in your hands, we have a vehicle with a problem that we can clearly see. We talked about some of these procedures in section one, but now we have a vehicle that we can apply it directly to, and I think it will help, okay? So just giving you a shot very quickly of the trouble codes on this car. We have multiple codes. Customer complaints, misfire, low power, choppiness, check engine light, okay? What we will see here in a second, my key is still on, correct?
Yep.
Watch our battery die on us. Okay. Current codes, random misfire, cylinder two, cylinder three, and then we have an igniter circuit fault. Okay, so remember that igniter circuit fault, cylinders two and three, and then a random. Very quick note on that, when we have, you can have single cylinder misfires cause all of this. Like we could literally have just a number two cylinder coil problem, for example, that's setting these other fault codes. Remember, the misfire monitor isn't perfect. It uses a high resolution crank sensor to monitor acceleration and deceleration rates of the crank, and they're not perfect. So I'm not gonna stress about this having multiple codes. We have a miss. We need to figure out which cylinder it's on. We have a guide, of course. History, I don't know if that'll be helpful or not. Same fault codes. Do you guys understand why my focus would be on the number two though right away? Not only do I have a number two misfire, but I have an igniter circuit fault. You guys don't know a lot about that. You're gonna have a little bit of a better idea here in a second. All right, so scan data really at this point isn't what I'm going after. I can feel the misfire, and there's, you know, to be quick about it, if I was working in the field, what I would probably do is I would go under the hood. I'll show you just a picture here of this. I'd go under the hood and I would, this will load. It's a coilover plug system. I would probably just unplug these coils one at a time. Would that be able to give me an RPM drop test and I could tell for sure which cylinder is giving me the misfire? We can do that. The only problem with that, and we almost started there, the only problem with that is when you unplug these coils, you would absolutely set an igniter code in doing so. So that number two igniter fault code, if we hadn't looked at the codes first, we may have had an issue with that. So that's one method. I don't want to use that method because of that igniter code that we had in there, and I don't want to force igniter codes by unplugging the coils, so we're not going to do the RPM drop test. Let me stop for a second. One of the hard parts about doing this, there isn't one right way to do things. There are so many different methods to attack this misfire, and you would not be wrong in picking any one of them. I feel it is my duty to give you every single one that I know in every single situation. Because not all systems, not all cars, you can use them all, but you need to know them all. Does that make sense? That's kind of my approach. So sometimes these can be a little overkill, and I want to stress again, my focus with this is the scope. Does that make sense? I want to do the scope part with you guys. I realize there's other ways to find the misfire. I want to do the scope part with you guys. All right. So when you're in the scan tool on the Verus, it's real easy to get to the scope. All you need to do is, and I can do it up here for you guys so you can see what I'm pushing rather than the stylus. All you need to do is hit this home tab. So that's the bottom left corner. Hit the home tab. Now we have everything else available to us. We're going to go to the scope multimeter. And we still have cam crank signals on Scott's car up here. This is an incorrect cam timing. I don't know if this will be something we'll be showing at another time or not, but let me go back. I didn't realize we had that loaded. No big deal. We're in our main scope menu. Let me go back one more time so we can see that. Go to our scope multimeter, and this is your next screen. We're going to go to the lab scope. And then on this particular screen, what you need to understand is everything that we're picking here is within the scope. So let me give you an example. If I want to measure volts DC, what you'll see on this screen is we have the ability down here to turn other channels on and off. Okay? The default setting for volts DC is a single channel scope. If I go back and I go to four channel lab scope, what you'll notice, it's the same screen, but the preloaded one would be all four channels are turned on at the same time. Okay? The next thing would be, let's say that I want to pick low amps 20. It's still my scope. If you notice, I can turn other channels on and off. But there are presets here. And by presets, what I'm talking about would be there is a amp clamp on channel 1 and an RPM pickup on channel 2 as a default. But watch this. If I go back and go volts DC, can I measure amperage on this? It's still the scope. Watch. Click the probe button. Low amps 20. Is that my amp clamp now set up there? And then can I turn channel 2 on and make that an RPM pickup? There was some type of ignition. Does that look like what our preset was on the last one? You guys understand that all of these tabs that they have for you on this are just presets that are within one scope. Does that make sense? Okay. When you use a scope, another important piece of information. On the left-hand column, this is going to be volts. And we're gonna have a delay here. This is not gonna work for me. Left-hand column is volts. The bottom, yeah. That's horizontal on the bottom. And on the left is volts. Now you're thinking, wait a minute, we got settings up here that say pressure and amperage and ignition. So maybe it's not always volts, right? On the left-hand column, this vertical one I'm talking about, let's just put a V here. There's volts and here's what? Time on every scope. Let's go low amps 20. Turn this channel off. Just want you guys to focus on my left. On my left scale here, this 2, I'm looking over here if you follow my little finger thing here. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, you guys follow? That's amperage, right? It's not. It's an amperage conversion. Low amp probes, an amp probe measures magnetic field strength. When you use an amp probe, everybody okay so far? I'm going to get to the car, but we need this preliminary stuff first. When we use an amp probe, we're using something like this. This is actually the exact amp probe, the exact car that we're working on. The amp probe, notice, has a jaw and a hole in the middle of it, so I'm looking. So we're all on the same page. I am looking right here. What are we measuring with that? What do we do with that? We measure magnetic field strength of a wire. So if a wire is passing through this, what we're doing is we are reading the magnetic field around that wire. What does the probe produce? It produces voltage. We're not producing current. We're producing voltage. An amp probe reads voltage, sends it to the scope. The scope has presets that tell the scales what to use. In other words, when we see 2 amps on the left screen over here, it's not 2 amps. It's actually, depending on the setting we're using on this amp probe, kind of tough to see this picture. I don't know if I have a better view of that. I'm looking. Yeah, you can't see it. There's a 20 amp setting and there's a 60 amp setting. You can kind of see it now. The 20 amp setting says 100 mV/A. What that means is the probe produces 100 millivolts per amp of current flow on that setting. And the one underneath it says 10 mV/A. The 60 amp setting means the probe produces every 10 millivolts is 1 amp of current. So if I'm set on a 20 amp setting, how many millivolts would be 2 amps? If 100 millivolts is 1 amp, 200 millivolts would be 2 amps. What you need to understand is on the scope, this two reading right here is really 200 millivolts. What did the scope do for us? It did the math because we picked a setting that says what? Low amps 20, which gauges the scope and the conversions of the scope to the setting of the amp probe. Questions so far? Do you understand that this just means we don't have to do the math? Do you also understand that this left margin, the vertical margin, is really volts with a math conversion over top of it? So what is a scope on the left column, on vertical? It's volts, period. And I can use the same example for pressure and ignition and amperage. It's a voltage conversion, okay? I get this question all the time. We measure ignition systems and we go ignition, and what you'll notice with ignition is these are KV readings. If I go to my scales on ignition, look at this, 20,000 volts, 50,000 volts, and I get people say, hey, you're putting 50,000 volts to your scope. No, I'm not. I'm putting a few volts on the scope using capacitive pickups that there's a conversion that's done that says, X amount of voltage equals 50,000 kV equivalent that's in that spark plug wire. So do you understand I'm not putting 50,000 volts to my scope? It's a voltage conversion. So just a little bit about volts. We're going to do on this Toyota, what we're going to do is a coil current test, okay? And what we need to do with a coil current test is we either individually look at the coils, or we look at them all at once. And so now what we're doing is we're plugging in section 3 information again. Can I see that wiring diagram that you're leaning on in the back? I don't know if I can show this. What year is this? 2002. Give me 1 second. It works. Yeah. All right, guys, look, I don't have my ink program on this, so you're gonna have to follow my little mouse key, okay? Do you see the ignition coils right here? What I look for, I wanna see all the coils at the same time, okay? I want to view all of them at once, so I don't have to keep moving my amp probe. This car's got a miss. I wanna see what all the coils look like. So I have a central ground location right here, and then I also have a power feed that would be shared. This black white wire here, 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 and here goes to this splice. Do you see it? And then it comes off the page over here on number one. Let me go to the next page, show you where it goes. On number one, the black white wire, it comes up to the ignition switch. So unfortunately, there are other circuits that are going to be powered on that, and it's not going to be an easy one to use. So my choice in this is going to be to go to this ground location. Where is this ground location? Left rear of the engine on the cylinder head. So let me show you the ground. I want to show you where I'm connected with this. And that is a picture of my grounds, which are right in here. Do you see these grounds right here? So how do we know where the left rear of the engine is? Place yourself in line with the transmission and look at the engine. I always thought the left of the engine was driver's side. That is not the case. It is for everything else on the car except for location on the engine. Put yourself where the transmission is. Where's the left side? So that's key. There's the grounds right there that I'm going to connect to. And when you use an amp probe, you also need to know that the amp probe is polarity sensitive. So you see the arrow right here? What the arrow tells us is direction of current flow conventional theory. That's positive to negative. So what do I want the arrow pointing at? I want the arrow pointing at my block. If you look at the picture, that you can see right there that the arrow is pointing actually the exact same way that my mouse is pointing to the left. Does that make sense? You guys also understand the theory behind current flow, that positive, we measure the feed side of the circuit or the control side of a circuit, and we can measure amperage to these coils. So I chose the ground because it was easy to do and I can read all four at the same time. Cool? So we're ready to start the car and see what the waveform looks like, right? Not yet. One more thing up top that we need to look at. And I'm gonna do this, we'll leave it alone, so I'll show you the picture. My setup up top on this scope is this right here. The amp probe is the red probe. It has a black lead too. You see the black leads to the left are tied together. What everyone wants to do when they pick up this amp probe is they always want to put it over here in channel 4. And I understand that. You're matching yellow to yellow on channel 1 and usually green to green on channel 2 and blue to blue on channel 3 if you're using them. And red, you see red and you put it on channel 4. What you need to understand is these amp probes are universal and they're used on multiple different tools. It's only red not to color coordinate it. It's red because that's a standard volt meter lead is red and black, right? Positive, negative. So don't do that. I need to know where I'm placing that amp probe. And in my case, I'm using channel 2. Okay. So let me do that channel first. I'll turn everything else off. So I'm actually turning channel 1 off. I'm turning channel 2 on. I need to tell it what I'm using, which is what? My amp probe in what setting? I'm using the 20 amp setting. It's important to have my scaling correct. If I choose the 60 amp or 40 amp, my scaling's going to be off. Okay, and then from this point, there's not a whole lot we need to do other than start the car. As far as time frame goes, that's going to take time to get used to adjusting, and I will intentionally set one that's probably too high and show you what it looks like. Can I get you to start the car? We have a hose on this?
Yes.
Okay. Guys, we have a misfire, and all we're trying to do is identify this misfire with a amp probe on a coil. Go ahead. Okay. I'm going to pause that for a second. Go ahead and shut that off. Okay. What this scope does is it has the ability to zoom. So did you see I just stopped the recording? This is a digital storage oscilloscope. That's what the advantage is of these is we have this zoom feature. And the zoom is over here on the right. So right down here, we hit that button. And you see the data that I recorded that's in this note. It's known as a buffer. It's a recording. You see where the car was off over in here. And then this is where the car was on. And I can zoom in on those waveforms. So I can go, there's times 32, times 16, times 8, times 4, down to times 1. Here's the problem. I can't zoom in any further than where I recorded it. When we take scope captures, we need detail and repetition. If you're using this scope, you need to set it for detail and zoom out. The zoom feature on this scope is a zoom out, not zoom in. Other scopes will use, you zoom in on the waveform. This one, you zoom out. So I want detail, right? I can't see what I want to see here. I'm going to not hit play. Watch. Remember we got screwed up on this the other day when we were looking at something, that cam crank on the Jeep, right? The cam was bad, cam sensor, and we were looking at a playback. If I hit play, the car's not running, but we have this waveform going on up here. That could throw you off. Imagine hooking up to the car now and you have a playback waveform. How do we recognize that? Right here, guys. I didn't notice, but here's the difference. Do you see the little camera icon right here? It's grayed out. We're in playback mode right now. That's the only difference. Watch when I stop it and then hit the red stop button. Notice the camera icon is now active. This is live, so you see the difference. How do we know when we screwed up? Stop, and then here's me screwing up. I'm hitting play instead of record, right? We think the scope is rolling. It's not. Imagine this screen. You're hooking up your scope and you're like, I can't get a signal anywhere. You can't get a signal anywhere because you're playing back a recording of nothing. I've been thrown off by this. So I just learned something when I edited that video is pay attention to that tab right there. Okay, hit stop. That's recording. Now, start the car back up. I'm gonna reset my time base. So what we're covering right now, real quick, is time base, a time base setting. I need detail. What do I need to do? Drop my time base. Click on that 500, drop it down. Let's get some detail. There's 20 milliseconds. I like that. Let's drop it even more. Now here's the problem. Leave it run. There's a problem on this screen. If you want to see detail live, you see it's rolling across the screen on me, and that kind of sucks. We can pause it now, and we can zoom. I'm going to show you two ways. Is this now giving me the best of both worlds? Can I look at detail and repetition? Right, we see some things, guys, if your eye isn't tuned to it yet. This is like Sesame Street right now. I used that analogy with you guys before. One of these kids is doing its own thing on here. We got four different coils. Can you pick it out? Remember the screen, three kids riding a bike, one kid riding a skateboard. We don't need any further than that to know we have a problem on one of these coils, right? This is why I chose this test and chose this moment to spend this time with you guys on the scope. So we're all clear on that. Can we see detail and repetition now? We can, but there's an issue with it live, going back live. It's rolling across the screen. This is where we use a scope trigger, watch. I'm over here. I'm clicking on this icon. And now what I've done, and it's up here, look at the plus sign. Grab this plus sign, move it over. That's called scope delay. Just telling the scope where to draw the waveform. You see that it now looks like sometimes it's good and sometimes it's bad, or you see the waveform changing, don't you? What that is that's all four coils being drawn over the same location on the scope because I set a scope trigger. I just triggered this waveform. Okay, there's settings with the trigger, and I'm gonna go up to my setup and set my trigger. I'm doing this fast for a reason. Number one, I have really good videos already on doing this. My suggestion to you guys is to watch my Picoscope Basics Part 1 and Part 2. I've probably done the best that I could with scope trigger and delay and all this stuff, okay? I'm going fast because we need to deal with this car. If I set this to manual mode for a trigger, it still looks good, right? We still see the waveform. Watch what happens if I go outside the trigger mode. We still have a waveform here, but the scope is not drawing it. Why is it not drawing it? Because it's not crossing that level. So the level is up, down. You follow? This is my level. I just changed the level. If I go too low, it's not going to draw it. If I go too high, it's not going to draw it. That's the level. Scope delay is left and right. I want to add some delay there. I can't see part of the waveform. Okay? The dangers of a trigger would be if you're acquiring a new signal and you didn't know and somebody else is using the scope. I mentioned this to one of you guys, a trigger, and I said, oh, okay, we're on auto, so we're okay. Do you understand trying to acquire a new signal, what I mean by that? Let's say you're checking a cam sensor signal and you're looking for a waveform and you're looking at this and you're like, I don't have a waveform. You don't have a waveform because you don't know what your trigger level is, and your trigger level is set outside of the range of that signal. So how do we fix that? Two ways. Number one, trigger, set it to none. I have no trigger set right now. Look at your levels. Can we see my min-max levels of this waveform now? Then set your trigger. Where? Inside of that waveform. Or We go to auto, and it will draw the waveform anyway, even though your trigger level is set outside of that. I'm going to leave that alone for now. There's times where I want to use a manual mode. There's times where I want to use an auto, and I go over that in those other videos. I'm going to move past that. Are you guys comfortable with at least the basics of that trigger level, how we want to set this level, not too high, not too low? All right. You guys understand that that's all four coils being drawn over top of each other. And if I want to freeze that pattern, go ahead and shut that off for a second. Freeze the pattern. And guys, by the way, this is some of your shop work. Brandon, you were asking me about that earlier, about how are we doing this? How are we saving these waveforms? This is part of what you need to know how to do. We can now zoom on this. I would want to take that capture. And I want to see the bad one. So maybe a good scope capture for this class would be, you know, take a look at, let me zoom out a little bit and show you how to do this. I'm going to take my center cursor and put it on that one. And then now what I can do is zoom back in, and I'm looking at that one in a detailed view. From here, I would simply hit the S button on my tool. You hear the camera sound. It just took a screenshot of that image, and it's a JPEG or bitmap image that can be used on any computer. There's your one screenshot. All right, from there, what I would do, I'd zoom back out, and then I'd take a picture of a what I'm calling for you guys a known good one. I would call that a good coil current ramp. Then I'd do the same thing. Okay, there's two. There's a known good, the known bad. Where do we find those? Home tab, data manager. What did I just do? I just took a couple screenshots, didn't I? So we'd find them in there. I'm gonna move away from that. Again, I have this entire Verus series on my channel. You guys can watch all the parts and how to do this stuff. Back to our car. Notice I went home, scope, I'm still rolling. It's still what we had before. That's really cool. I didn't lose anything. All right, here's my question to you guys now. Let's focus on the car a little bit. I want to know, I think you guys can maybe see it too. Let me get a level where we can see it together. That might be it right there. Can you see that this one right here, that's that crappy looking one, is also occurring right there? And it's also occurring right here. Let's get rid of that. It's also occurring right here. Can you guys see that? How many cylinders does this car have? Four. All right, so it would make sense we see that same one every four times. That's the same coil. All right, which one is it? It might be the number two. My money is on it being the number two. You guys understand why we would think that? Let me ask you this. Are all four coils firing? I've given you enough in week one to answer that question as far as current flow goes on an ignition coil, and when a coil fires is when we turn the base circuit off and when we stop current flow. And each coil is producing around 10 amps of current. What do you think about the control of the coils? What did we have? We had an igniter control trouble code, right? Didn't we? Yep. Home, scanner. This is also a nice thing about this tool. And I won't lose my scope stuff. Key on?
Yep.
We have an igniter circuit fault. Guys, when you see an igniter circuit fault, we worry about control. We worry about the computer wiring to that. What I'm telling you guys based on this waveform is there's no issue with the igniter as far as controlling the coil. What would it look like? I'll show you after we figure out which one this is. I'll unplug a coil and show you the waveform. Here's my issue though. Are we sure it's the number two? We don't know because we're looking at all four, right? Could I move my amp probe individually now to each coil and figure out which one has that pattern? I could, but look at the picture of these coils on this car. It's a little bit hard to get that amp probe where this conduit is, wouldn't you say? I'd have to split each one of them with a razor blade, and that's not a problem. We can do that. I'm not going to do it that way. This is a four-wire coil. The transistors are inside of the coil on this, and I want to go to the control wire on one of the coils. And what that's going to provide me with is a sync signal for this other one. I'll show it to you in a second. Which one do we go to? This is what we do in the field, trying to be quick. I am looking, see if this works. It's a little bit slow. I am looking at the wire colors. This is probably the best one to look at. On to the right, I have a black and white. And then next to that, I have a blue with a yellow. And then I have a yellow and this one's brown and something, right? I'm looking at all four coils and I see something that's similar. There's another black and white down here. There's another brown. There's another blue, yellow. Let's look at this one. Black, white, blue, yellow, brown. I know the picture's not real clear. Black, white, blue, yellow, I think, and brown. So all these coils are sharing these circuits, aren't they? Which one do you think the control circuit is? When we talk about control for an ignition coil, we're talking about one that's unique to a cylinder that fires when that cylinder is at top dead center compression around that area. It's the wire colors that are different. So without looking at the wiring diagram, I know that that's the control wire on my number four coil. How did I figure that out? I didn't use the diagram. Wire color, knowing ignition design, knowing the transistors inside the coil. So what you need to know is this second channel is connected to the base control circuit. Here's, just to give you guys a visual, and this is going to be slow, so I'll have to take my time in drawing this, and sorry, that's horrible. Transistor is in the coil. And what we're connected to, these legs up top, that's my load. This is the side that's connected to the base. So what is that doing to that transistor? That signal. It's turning it on, turning it off, turning it on, turning it off. All right, let me show you the waveform. I'm already connected on the scope. How do we do it? We unfreeze this. Unfreeze this. And then turn channel one on, which is where my other lead is, right? That's where I have my voltage settings. You guys follow? I'm sharing a ground. Channel one is my yellow trace. Okay? On the scope, I turn channel one on. And I don't want it inverted. That turns the waveform upside down. I don't necessarily need it peak detected. I'm not going through that. This is actually the wrong probe. That's ignition. Volts is what I want. 20 volt is good. Start the car. Let it roll for a minute. There's other ways we can do this. All right, that works. Shut it off. All I did was let that record for a second. I paused it. I'm going to let review the buffer. And we got something cool going on now. What do you guys see up here?
It's happening right after.
But the yellow trace is what? Isn't that my number four cylinder base circuit control? I know that because I'm connected to the number four, right? So could I maybe know, do I know which one? Isn't our concern this one? Do I know which one that is? I still don't. How do I figure it out? What do I do? There you go, man. Firing order. I need a firing order, right? So I got to look up on Mitchell the firing order for this car. Let's do that. Go back to here real quick. By the way, I want you guys to take a look at the coils themselves. You see the red, blue, yellow, green, gray, and white are the unique colors. The brown are shared, the blue, yellow shared, the black, white is shared. Okay, there's other characteristics of this coil system we could do, but not right now. We're doing the scope. We're just trying to identify which cylinder this is. I hope you guys are following. I need a firing order. I know you guys need to leave, but I'm not letting you leave early today. Firing order. Engine performance. What is this thing? So where are we at? 1342, we have some footnotes though. Camry, this is Celica, Corolla. 2 and 3, firing order is not available from the manufacturer. That sucks. What? Are you kidding? Why would the firing order not be available from the manufacturer? All right, well, what's our Camry? 1342. Let's see if that matches where we are. I don't know if we can rely on that or not now.
I don't think so.
I know. What was it, 1342? All right, I'm triggered off of number 4, right? That'd be cylinder 3 would be right here. Let me do one other thing. Hit the home tab. I'll go to my guided component tests.
Well, based off of that right there where it's not giving you the firing order, couldn't you just switch that probe to the...
I could. Yeah, I could absolutely do that. There are other ways to do this, and that would be one, which is connect individually to each coil. Let me just see if this gives it to me under here, because it might give me the firing order. This is a guided test for this tool. No. One, three, four, two is a firing order. Okay. Right there, you see it? And that's for this 2002 Toyota Corolla. So what we thought, guys, was the number 2. Yeah, hold on, let's get back to my scope. We go to our, did I close that? No. Let's go back. Sorry, home, scope, multimeter. That's, according to the firing order, guys, this is my number 3 cylinder. So how about I reach down and unplug the number 3 and let's see what it looks like. Start the car up. One other thing I can do, I'm gonna change my trigger to my yellow trace. Watch what happens. Now I'm just looking at, that's just the number 4 now. I'm going to change my time base a little bit so we can do this live together. I want to see multiples on the screen. All right, which one are we focused on? The one to the left of that trigger. You guys with me? I'm going to unplug, reach down and unplug the number 3. Start that back up. Shut the key off. Wait for a second. Start it back up. Keep it running with your foot. It doesn't like that, does it, with that coil? Do you see it's the one that's missing, though?
Yeah.
Start it back up again. All right. Let's go back and take a look at that. That'll work. That's the first time I've seen one not run with one coil unplugged. It really doesn't like what it's seeing on that. Hey guys, at this point, you're just gonna be waiting in line, so just bear with me for a minute, okay? Just relax. Everybody can stop being all stressed out about getting out of here. Take a look. The one that had the bad waveform is the number 3. We all thought it was number 2, right? Fire, but you guys understand what we did. We took a sync signal with the firing order. We figured out what was what. I realize there's other ways to do this, but how cool was that? Let's plug that coil back in. Go ahead and start the car. I don't know why that one looks like it's coming and going. I believe that's my recording that's doing that. That's not the scope. You see all that one blip in the screen right there? See, it's happening on both channels. That's not, that's this recording that's bogging this program down. So he's got no spark from his number three coil, guys. I know you're probably thinking, how do you know that? Shut that off. That's not something we're doing right now. What we'll do is we'll get this car back because he's ready to go. You guys are ready to go. We'll get this car back tomorrow, and I'll show you that this reading right here, where is my cursor? This guy right here should have zoomed in a little bit more. Hold on 1 second. Start that back up. All right, shut it off. That's a good ramp. We did talk about shorted secondaries, right? And the ramp pattern of a shorted secondary. That's what I'm going after here, guys. That's what I'm looking at. I know we really can't see the turn on oscillations real well with this one. Let's look at a good one. Let's look at that one. Can't really see it right in here. That's where we're looking, right? But what do we see? You see a line that's curved right away, don't we? And the other ones all look that way. Let's take a look at number four. A little bit of characteristic difference at the top. I'll do it this way now. I can move the... And there's my number three. What do you guys think? I am absolutely confident that there's no spark coming from this number three coil. You need one ignition coil. Get me a spark plug too for this. I don't want to mess around with the plug. I want a coil and a plug. I'm not promising you that everything else is okay. This is late in the day and I would want to do some further checks and on this system, but I'm comfortable initially looking at the rest of these waveforms that I have spark from these other coils. Here, we didn't look at that one. How's that ramp? Looks pretty decent. Here's the another one, and then this is the number four. A little bit of dwell time differences, but that's okay. The ramps look good. The one that doesn't look good. Now, why would we tell him we're worried about other issues? What do you guys think? I mean, we definitely have a number three coil issue. I want a plug and I want a coil. Wait, let me back up. Could we have, I showed you guys a variable here. Remember my smash spark plug? Could we have a smash spark plug and not have a bad coil at all? You need to wait. You need to bring me this car back.
I forgot. I have so much going on now. One of my twins, we're getting her lip done tomorrow, so I won't.
No problem. When you bring it back, okay. I need to see this car back. But are you guys with me on my smash spark plug? We shouldn't rush the call in this shorted secondary, right? These go bad a lot, so I'm kind of using experience with that. But I think before we call the coil on this, we need to look at that spark plug, make sure we don't have a short in there. You could probably line up a coil and a spark plug, and worst case scenario is I say, hey, we didn't need the coil, you can take it back. Okay. Does that sound good?
Yeah.
That way we have the part when you come back.
Yeah.
Why? What else do we need to warn him about? We had a number two cylinder igniter circuit fault code. Could we have another coil that's breaking down with heat and temperature? And, you know, we don't want to say he needs all the coils, but as a customer, as a paying customer, if he was, wouldn't we want to communicate that we're worried about this number two coil as well? So, but we're going to start with what we know, which is this waveform right here. When he brings his car back, we'll pull it. I'll show you guys the coil test, and then we'll pull the spark plug and take a look at that. Yeah.
Have you ever seen Toyota have the same problem as that Ford truck where that shade recurs a little bit?
I haven't. Good question. So what David was asking is, could our identification of the number two actually be the number three? And I haven't seen that on anything other than the Ford truck, but doesn't mean it's not possible. So in other words, a misidentification of which cylinder is misfiring. All right. Any other questions on what I did with the scope? You guys have a little bit better idea of it. Again, I highly suggest that you guys watch my either my Verus series that I have online or my Pico scope 1 and 2 that I have up there as well, as far as homework on that. And we'll do more scope stuff along the way. I just thought this car would be a good one to start with. So.